It is a fact that there are power cuts in large parts of the country. So, I mean, obviously to a layman, there is a huge contradiction between a power cut and someone in a forum like this saying that we are power excess. But I mean, the reason is that, I mean, I'm also an engineer by education, so pardon me for saying this, but I mean, most engineers don't have, most engineering courses don't have a course in economics. If you look at a basic curve in economics, it says that demand is a function of price. Now, most engineers tend to calculate demand by multiplying the population or the number of households by the expected average consumption in a household, and they arrive at a number. And unfortunately, the problem with Excel sheets is that they always give you an answer. Whatever numbers you feed in, they always give you an answer. So through such Excel sheets, we have arrived at a number of for the demand of the country and CA moved accordingly. But the problem is that that demand is very often from people who are not willing to pay. So, I mean, there is no concept in economics of a demand at zero price. So the problem is that, I would advise or suggest to many of you, there was a film made called, what was the name? It's about Kanpur. Someone from UP, what is it called? When you hook a line onto the Katiyabaz. So the name of the film was Katiyabaz. It's a beautiful film. I met the director of the film as well. The person is an Indian origin living in Germany. He came to Kanpur in India, in UP, in India, and he just shot what was actually happening. And it was just a story on power theft. And after he shot everything, he made it out into a film. So the short story being that the MD of the Kanpur distribution company, I'm forgetting the name of the lady. She's presently in REC. So she was the MD. And she tried to stop power theft. And there is a Samajwadi Party MLA. She has a conflict with him and so on. And the beauty of the film is that all of it was actually what happened. And later it was made into a film. So what was mentioned in the film is actually a representative of what is there in almost throughout the country. Almost throughout the country, the problem is that if a DISCOM has 10 customers, only 7 out of those customers pay, 3 don't pay. So because of that, power supply becomes a loss-making proposition for the DISCOM. So the way out of a loss-making proposition is that you supply less of power to reduce your losses. So that is what the DISCOMs are doing. So the basic problem is that till this is addressed, till the theft at the DISCOM level is addressed, till that there can be no short-term solutions. It is just like, I mean, if there is a problem in the body, if there is an infection in the body, just having crocine can only lower the temperature. Unless you address the infection, the basic problem cannot go away. So the problem of the DISCOM are the losses of DISCOM, or rather the theft of DISCOMs. A few misconceptions that are there about this whenever I have come to such gatherings in Delhi is very often people living in South Delhi. I mean, I was born in Delhi and I studied in Delhi IIT. So pardon me when I, you know, talk derisively about South Delhi, because I also know only South Delhi well. Anyway, so the problem of, you know, people living in South Delhi is that we tend to say that you know, the problem is because of free power to the farmers. Now, let me clarify, that is not the problem. Because whatever free power, quote-unquote free power is given to the farmers, the state government gives a actual budgetary support to that extent to the DISCOMs. And it actually is a help to the DISCOMs because the farmers may or may not pay, whereas the government does pay. So whereas the recovery percentage, had they to recover that money from the farmers, might be 50-60%, whereas the government pays entirely. So the problem of DISCOMs is not because of free power. The problem of DISCOMs is because of theft and low collections in the DISCOMs. Now, if you look at the DISCOMs, most states in the country have this situation of what we call power excess. I mean, as I admitted, power excess is not because there is actually a power excess, but more because of losses, DISCOMs don't supply 24/7. And because of that, the felt demand or the actual demand decreases. The real demand might be more, But the demand, as it affects the market, as it moves to the market, that reduces. I mean, I must be honest, in our, for example, Madhya Pradesh. In Madhya Pradesh, in 2012, we had a conscious, or 13, we had a conscious policy, something called Atal Jyoti Abhiyan, that we would move into 24/7 power scenario. We have excess power, but if you go to the field, you would find that there are power cuts. Now, I tried to find out a lot as to why that is happening, because we have excess power. Very often, we had to shut down power plants, because there is a no demand, and at the same time there were power cuts. And I must tell you, the reason for that is so tragic and stupid. And I must say that when you have a shutdown of a power plant, you have to pay the fixed cost anyway. It's only the variable cost that you're saving. So if typically a plant costs 4 rupees, typically 2 rupees are your fixed cost and another 2 would be the variable cost. So anyway, you are paying 2 rupees. So the reason for the power cut at the ground level is that when you have to judge the efficiency of a field officer, how do you judge it? You judge it by the revenue collected by him or under his jurisdiction, divided by the number of energy units input into that area. That is simple, it's called RPU, revenue per unit. Now, in large parts of India, there is no actual billing. There is no actual metering, there is no billing. So what happens is that very often, there is an average billing, that without metering, there is an average bill that is given. It is possible that in certain cases, it is because of lethargy. It is also possible that there is a local ground level corruption that is the reason for that. But whatever be the reason, the amount of revenue that the field officer can collect from his area is almost fixed. It is irrespective of the amount of power that is actually being input. So as he has no control over the numerator, he can control the denominator by reducing the actual power input. So the actual reason for a power cut, and because of that, the reduced power demand in the country, are reasons like this. Which is very tragic, but which is what it is. Also, I would say that it is stupid and tragic because, I mean, the example that I gave, that out of 10 people, 7 pay for their power and 3 do not pay for their power. The problem is that all those 10 have to suffer the power cut because there is no silver bullet that can go to the 7 people who paid their power, not to the 3 people who did not pay a power. Unfortunately, I mean, in telecom, you can do that. You can switch off the mobile signals for those 3 people and continue for the remaining 7 people. I mean, it's not possible till now in electricity. So the tragic thing is that all 10 of them have to suffer power cuts. And frankly, in today's day and world, you cannot survive without power. So when there is a power cut, there is definitely some alternate source of power. It could be a diesel generator. Like I suppose it's there in large parts of UP. And in Bihar, I have seen that there is actually a temporary connection from a diesel generator that's actually sold to you. So you can draw power through that temporary connection. Every connection has a rate, like 2 fans or a cooler or a fan or so many bulbs and so many fans and so on and so forth. So, but whichever alternative source of power is used, the rate is almost always higher than what you are paying to the DISCOM. So the tragedy is that if everyone were to be paying their bills, then everyone would be getting 24/7 power supply. The power plants that are closed in India for lack of demand would be running, and there would be greater demand of renewable energy, and the question that he raised might not have been raised. So that is the tragedy in India, but well, and so many things, it's not possible for, you know, that right thinking to percolate down the level. But so now addressing the question, can there be a financial incentive? Not, I do not think so, because the DISCOM, the very often we say that solar is now below 3 and coal is costlier, so people would move to solar. Now, this is a partly correct argument. It is partly correct because in a state like Assam, I mean, Assam team visited Madhya Pradesh. They are short of power. They have to set up a new power plant. So they are thinking in terms of setting up a solar plant rather than a thermal plant, because as just mentioned, that solar is below 3 and coal would be around 4. So they're setting up a new solar plant. But now let's move to a state which is already power excess. Now, if it is power excess, it anyway has to pay the fixed cost of the thermal plant. That is a given, that's a gone thing. Now, the only difference is between the variable cost and the cost of solar. Still, the solar power has not become cheap enough to be lesser than the variable cost. The costliest, if you leave aside gas-based thermal power plants, even the most expensive coal-based thermal power plant would not have a variable cost of more than 2 rupees 25 paisa or 2 rupees 50 paisa. And solar would definitely be costlier than that. So for a DISCOM, for usual DISCOM, which is power excess, it still does not make sense to procure solar energy over contracted thermal energy. It might make more sense for them to source solar energy over new contract of thermal energy. Yes, it makes sense, like in a case of Assam, which I mentioned. However, in a state like Madhya Pradesh, like Maharashtra, Gujarat, which are power excess, there, because they have to pay fixed cost, and variable cost is still lesser than the cost of solar plant, it still does not make sense. So it is a commercially not a commercially appropriate decision for DISCOMs to increasingly procure more solar energy. So the question that you raised, now, can there be a way to financially compensate them? Well, I mean, DISCOMs are intelligent enough to know that they are losing more than what they are gaining. So if it is through a regulatory diktat, yes, it can happen, but it cannot happen on commercial principles. You cannot, you know, bribe them enough, you know, that, okay, we would give you, you know, this much money, so please accept. I mean, so that doesn't make sense, because they know that the quantum of loss that they suffer is more than what you are giving to them. So a few suggestions, I think, are doomed to failure, even on paper, even before they're implemented. One is to give financial incentive to DISCOMs for solar rooftop, because DISCOMs know, because, I mean, people who run DISCOMs are also engineers like you and me. And though, I mean, economics might not be their forte, but definitely mathematics is. And equality and inequality, inequality is a fairly simple thing to say, that 3 is bigger than 2. I mean, anyone would know it. So DISCOMs know fairly well that they would lose far more, because someone who sets up a solar rooftop is a high paying customer who also pays. I mean, you don't expect solar rooftops in jhoggi jhopadis, which are have low rates and which pay less. Solar rooftops would be in houses and residential complexes and offices and factories of people who have the highest slabs of tariff and who regularly pay. So DISCOMs know that if they have solar rooftop, then these customers would slip away from their setup. Who's the customer?
As I said,
I'm presently looking after renewable energy, so do not consider that I'm speaking from the other side. However, I'm just trying to explain to you the DISCOM's point of view. I understand your point. I myself fight on behalf of renewable energy. That is what I am doing. However, I am telling it from DISCOM's point of view. For DISCOM, it is a loss-making proposition if a customer slips away. Similarly, if the another concept of you awarding DISCOMs for procuring renewable energy, that also is doomed to failure, because they know that they can compare that how much fixed cost they would anyway have to pay. So essentially, they would say that, I mean, by not taking thermal power, they would be not taking, say, paying variable cost of 1 rupee 50 paisa and buying solar at 2 rupee 50 paisa. So they know that they're losing 1 rupee. They can multiply the number of units in the year, and they can see that what the government of India is giving is not good enough for that. So till now, we have moved on the path of RPO, which has been partly successful in greater acceptance of renewable energy in the states. As renewable energy costs have gone down, definitely the acceptance of renewable energy has increased, and that is a path that we need to work on. But subsidizing DISCOMs for doing this, I don't think it is likely to succeed. However, yes, two things can, which I've been thinking of. That is increasing the demand. One is obviously reducing the DISCOM losses, but that's a long-term agenda. Another is, if you want to kickstart the demand of power in the country, three things come to my mind. I will not talk about them in great detail. One is electric cars, electric vehicles. That happens, that increase the demand of energy in the country. That is using energy for cooking. Because using LPG, propane and butane for burning it for cooking chapatis is criminal. So that is, again, if something could be done, and even in Madhya Pradesh, we are working on this. And the third is exporting power to neighboring countries. So these are three things that I think should happen to kickstart the demand. Of course, I mean, make in India and industrial demand should happen, but I'm sure this is going to take time.
Manuji, just one again, best point. Thank you so much for giving such a passionate kind of a plea, you know, of passionate understanding of what the DISCOM faces. But just wondering, Manuji, do you believe, so you mentioned these three things, electric vehicles are a key, I think, so not only for India's energy security now, but also us achieving the 175 renewable target, because demand needs to be created for that. Just wondering, do you believe also on the regulatory tariff side, some of our tariff policies are a relic of the deficit era? For example, for a good paying customer, if I go above 1,000 units, suddenly I'm charged a much, much more premium. Is it now, obviously, you know, we don't want power wastage, but at least can some balance now be brought? Because if I'm a, let's say I'm a residential affluent customer, if you give me a discount above 1,000 units, maybe then I will adopt an electric vehicle, or maybe I will take an electric cooking stove. Otherwise, I don't have an incentive to do that. I think some of the regulatory mechanism now start to reflect a power surplus or a demand invigorating kind of a strategy now.
Yeah, I would fully agree with that. I would also tell you the reason for that. See, most regulators, age of superannuation for regulator is 65 years. So most regulators are around that. So, 1991 really marks a watershed in terms of how India thinks and how India as a nation thinks and how Indians think. So before that, yes, there was a deficit mindset, yes. Also, there was a socialist mindset. So these are the two things that make you think in a certain way. So yes, you're absolutely right. In a situation where we want to encourage people to use electricity, our regulations are such which actually encourage people to use less electricity. And very often, decisions are made accordingly, industrial decisions. So we have moved in a certain, to a certain extent in that direction, with certain time and day tariff being implemented in certain states for certain categories of customers. But increasingly, yes, we have to convey to regulators. Also, I would say that, see, typically, whenever such an issue confronts a regulator, there are two, you can say, mindsets. One is that of the conventional electricity or the DISCOMs. And another is that of the renewable energy. So, also I would say that regulators tend to sympathize or tend to have the interests of the DISCOMs closer to their heart than renewable energy. So, these are the constraints, or these are the ground realities, because which I feel that, even we in Madhya Pradesh had to struggle a lot with this. For example, when our net metering regulations were initially notified, the highest size of RE system that they allowed was 112 kilowatt. So with a lot of persuasion, finally it is now 1 megawatt. So a lot of such things, initially it was only for LT customers. Now it is allowed also for ST customers. So there's a lot of struggle when you try to convince regulators to have slightly friendly regulations for renewable energy.
Right.
Another example that might comes to my mind is at the national level, that is of the transmission charges. Of the ISTS charges. Now, as we all know that, solar energy, for example, or wind energy has a CUF of around 20-25%. So, in India, the transmission charges are on the per megawatt basis. Now, the logic that Power Grid gives for that is that for every source, you have to set up a capacity to evacuate that source. And because of that, it has to be on megawatt basis, even though solar energy is produced in the morning and not in the evening. So the PGCIL's argument is that as the transmission system would be standing even in the night, even though it is not used, so we have to charge for that. Now this again is a deficit era mindset, because there was a time when all these regulations set up that power generation determined the power transmission capacity, because there was an infinite capacity for demand. There was a huge demand in the country. I mean, huge, I mean, relative to the then existing generation. And the limiting thing was the generation. So whatever was generated was transmitted and consumed. Now we have moved to the other end, where the consumption is what limits the generation. So now consumption remains the same. So now perhaps it's an appropriate time that, so if the solar is produced in the day and not produced in the night, so what is happening, the thermal steps in the night, and the same transmission channel is used for thermal energy, and thermal perhaps is shut down in the day. So now perhaps we need not have, so it is incorrect to say today that if we have a solar system, so transmission system set up for solar is unused in the night. No, it is not unused in the night, it's used for thermal in the night. So it might make more sense to move in to a per energy cost of transmission cost. So the ISTS charges in India presently are per megawatt. It might make more sense to have a per unit charges. For example, in Madhya Pradesh, for the state transmission, we have, for renewable energy, we have per unit charges rather than per megawatt charges.
I think very, very well said, sir. I think, you know, again, all these things require a change of mindset, regulation, and I'm sure things are moving in this direction, you know. At this stage, let me also just get some of the other panelists, you know, on the stage, and you know, Mr. Rabindra Sundarsingh from SoftBank Energy. Is he here? Mr. Vineet Taneja, Assistant General Manager, Semcorp. Welcome, Vineet. And Mr. Rahul Kshetrapal, Vice President, Sterling and Wilson. So. We'll just open the question once again for Manu sir, you know, but Mr. You know, but as of now, let me ask Mr. C. Narasimhan, ex-member of parliament, chairman Rasi Group of Energy of Companies, and president Indian Solar Association, to just give his initial thoughts.
Other parts of the country as well as other countries also, I could see some of the delegates came from China. Some of the other media people also entered this venue. When I welcome all of you, the people, they asked me to wind up the speech in a short span of time, but I am not going to do that, sorry. This is one of the thirst area of the government. Today, what we are passing through, lot of turbulence in the solar, all has to be addressed. My friends are talking in a different way. First, I would wish and I would like to see that all our ambitions are fulfilled, whether it's a farmer, whether it's a solar rooftop, or whether it's an energy vehicle or energy storage. Yes, India has created a wonderful policies. But how to implement? Who are the authorities to implement? Who are the decision makers? When I call for this every function of EQ International, I insist my friends, Mr. Anand Gupta, you must bring the decision makers on the dais today, like what we had two gentlemen. One is from MNRE, Joint Secretary Mr. Gopalji, and as well as the Rewa reformist Mr. Manu. I am grateful to all of you, sir, because the officials are the architect of this country. Whatever the government plans and keep the policies, you are the authorities to see that this reaches to the common man and to the industries. Once again, I welcome all of you for this meeting on behalf of Indian Solar Association. I represent Indian Solar Association as well as the other organizations, and I'm a coordinator for Invest India in the country for attracting investments. EQ International is keep on conducting various conferences. Once again, my congratulations for all of them. Sir, my friend from S-Bank has raised many questions regarding the farmers, regarding rooftops and all. Before going for all, let us achieve in this country what the farmer wants, the uninterrupted power for 24/7. So let us install all the solar pumps across the country in all the farmer lands. Then we talk about how to infuse the excess power produced by him either to the grid or how to solve the problems. So we are at the preliminary stage. Various governments for the past 3 years, after our Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji has taken charge, and a lot of initiation has taken place. Even day after tomorrow, everybody knows that International Solar Alliance, the founding day ceremony also being going to held up in Rashtrapati Bhavan, lot of 26 foreign countries also taking part of that. We are proud at this movement to see all these events are taking place. At the same time, there are a lot of grievances in the sector also. I suggest, first of all, as raised by some of my friends, the issues related for the lands, which is the primary requirement of solar power plant, has to be cleared off, has to be set up. What is the initiation, the policy created by the government as on date? Everybody knows that we are in the federal system. Each and every state government may have different policies, even in the acquisition of the land. Karnataka government has announced that 90 days a deemed concession can be given for the all solar developers. But still, in many of the solar parks, we are facing the land issues. Even in the private sector, we are facing the land issues. So I suggest the government of India, like how one country, one tax, we want to create one country, one policy, one tariff, one bank, and one kind of solution for all these grievances. First, the lands problems should be sorted out. Then the grids has to be strengthened by green corridor or strengthening the existing DISCOM grids. We know very well in this country many DISCOMs are under losses. My friend was asking, how can you incentivize the solar additional rooftop or the farmer production? I am asking, how to incentivize the DISCOM first? Many of the DISCOMs are in loss. So we brought Uday scheme. Many of the DISCOMs joined. After that, all the debts has been come down. For example, in Tamil Nadu, my Tangedco was facing 42,000 bad debts. After joining in Uday scheme, today they are just started making as a profit-oriented organization. Our policy now towards the DISCOMs, how to strengthen the DISCOM, to stabilize the DISCOM, how to manage the payments for the renewable energy sector bills. This is to be first to be established, the mechanism. Unless until you make the payment for the generation of the power, the developer will be losing. Yes, it is given by nature, solar power. Yes, we too agree, there is no requirement for much raw material other than the capital investment. But what is the capital investment also is the cost. So that has to be honored by DISCOMs in proper time, and there should not be any renegotiations on the PPS signed. This has created a lot of doldrums and confusions among the investors across the globe. This is a major issue. Either Gujarat or any of the part of the country, there is no need to renegotiate for any of the PPAs. It has been stipulated, it has to be mandated by Government of India through the Renewable Energy Organization, and the DISCOMs to listen for that. So this is what we need from the developers. So stabilizing the DISCOM, honoring the payments, aggregating the lands. I can suggest this country is having a lot of barren lands available in all the states. Let us request the Government of India, you identify all such barren lands to be established for the solar power, then the land issues can be sorted out. But all those barren lands where the solar power is coming up, all this grid connectivity also to be established. This is what we look forward. And again, I would like to mention that end of the day, it is not only the payment, again, the cost, the development cost and the investment cost has to be supported by the low-cost funding, which is what we are lagging behind. My friend sitting on dais is from S Bank. I would like to request S Bank or any other bank, for the past 2 weeks, the ISA has come forward to mix and match, inviting all the bankers, those who are committed in the RE Invest, to support the solar power projects. How many banks has completed that target? We have to reinvest, and we have to see that banks, I am not talking as politician, I am talking as industrialist. I am also a solar power developer from Tamil Nadu. How the developers are suffering for want of funds today, we know, sir. Every bank has closed the door in the recent past after the Nirav Modi issues. When the banks are going to support this kind of wrong trading and illegal activities, my genuine request to all the banks, all the power, all the institutions in this country, to support exclusively solar power generator or renewable power generator at low cost funding. Yes Bank today accumulated with a lot of funding from abroad, in pension fund, insurance fund, or any funds. European Bank is investing, Asian Development Bank is investing, World Bank identified various projects. But the truth is, today, none of the Indian banks are ready to reduce the rate of interest below 8.5 or worst come as 8.25. Why this? When you want the low cost power, why can't you reduce the cost of the interest? This is the basic question I am raising with all the financial institutions. I brought big delegation even to our industry and Ministry of Commerce to come out of the switch, to come out of the grievance of the anti-dumping. My friends from China, they asked me, China Chamber of Commerce represented, everybody represented. Yes, at this moment, this confusion is not required. We want to balance this country, one side the manufacturing, yes, make in India. The other side, 175 gigawatt renewable energy. Both has to be balanced. We need not fight for their issues and our issues. What is our issue? When you sign a PPA, when you undertake a tender, there should not be any kind of doldrums, there should not be any kind of troubles for the developer issuing in between the kind of imposing of anti-dumping duty or the safeguard duty. All the duties can be come. It can be imposed on the developer after some time. Today, our requirement is to reach the target of 100 gigawatt. Everybody is talking, yes, 20 gigawatt we achieved in India. How we are going to achieve another 80 gigawatts in the solar? Where is the source for funding at low cost? Where is the question of removing the confusion from the anti-dumping and the safeguard duty? Beyond that, every developer, they suffered a lot in all the shipments, whatever they brought to many ports of this country. 4,000 megawatt of solar panels has been held up because there was no clearance. There is no any clear-cut identification. This product should be identified for this much of customs import duty. My friends, I am not discouraging any one of you. I am representing the, facing the problems today after 3 years, after 4 years, when we think that when just we floated, created the policy to go for 175 gigawatt. Now we achieved, only we achieved about 20 gigawatts. Definitely India can achieve remaining also, provided there should be a supporting policy, there should be a supporting low-cost funding, there should be support for acquiring the lands without any problems. One of a great developer of this country who is manufacturing the panel cells and as well as EPC company as well as the solar power module manufacturer, they acquired a land, but within 15 days, they could not enter the land because of other issues, local issues, they have come out. This kind of issues has to be kept full stop. Then, coming for all these talks, what we are having, EV, ESS, everything we are talking, energy, storage, yes, we welcome. But where is the storage basin? Do you have any battery plant in this country, lithium-ion battery plant? No. We talk too much on that. I am not opposing, but I want to tell the truth. I want to ask the government, though I am from Bharatiya Janata Party representing, and as well as various organizations represent, I am saying with all the people, instead of going for a vast advertisement, you create a lot of R&D, you support R&D. All these 40 years, 50 years, the government has not spent money much on the R&D. Now we have to create a lot of center for excellence. Now we have to create a lot of demo plants in this country. I appreciate now NICE, Indian Solar Association, ISA has come forward to support a lot of new technologies. I support that. My dear friends, based on this, now some of the module manufacturers, some of the cell manufacturers approaching the government, yes, they want to see that no losses for them also. They are also Indian, they are also our partners, they are also our citizens, yes. We want to support them under Make in India, manufacturing sector to be strengthened. How it is to be strengthened? Incentivize, support them, not to kill the developers, not to kill the existing solar projects. Already the chit has come that we have to break for tea. Before tea, now, 2-3 issues I started representing. Whenever I start representing the issues, this kind of shits will come. But I don't stop because we want to achieve Modi's dream of 100 gigawatt. We want to see that India is not bypassing the China. When I was addressing the conference in China, my friends knows that I declared in front of all the delegates, yes, India is your competitor, not the enemy. Don't consider us an enemy. We are your competitor. We want to follow you in mega-scale manufacturing. In the same way, this country, solar module, cell manufacturing to be supported. I am requesting MNRE officials, don't take much time, don't waste much time. Earlier, manufacturing policy was defeated. Now I know MNRE is under preparation of a new policy for supporting the new manufacturing era. Yes, this has to be published in a month time. How much time we can wait for taking the policy in this country? No, we don't want to waste our time. One way you support the solar developer, other way incentivize the manufacturing entities, support the manufacturing. I am talking truly, we talk about 20 gigawatts, first year module, second year cell, third year wafer. Where we'll go for ingot, where we'll go for polysilicon, this also to be given a serious thought. Polysilicon, unless until we manufacture in this country, ingot has to be manufactured in this country. But now we can keep a view, first 5 years, yes, we can import the ingot, we can slice into wafers, we can go for cells, we can go for modules, apply a new technology. Yesterday, Inglis has announced that 12 bus bar module plant they identified, they exposed into Japanese exhibition. Yeah, we welcome that. Invite all the developers, invite all the technological company, invite the global leaders to India, attract them. As per my knowledge, only Lanji has committed and they are honoring the commitment to start their production in India. Other companies just, they announced, they went out. We have to review why they are going back. We want to bring them. We want to identify new technology in module manufacturing, cell manufacturing, how to reduce the cost in the manufacturing, how to support the existing manufacturing. All these are to be balanced. And now, only one clear cut we have to talk. This country decided to support to go for the clean energy and no more dirty energies. Yes, people are talking from the other sector, conventional energy. How can you live only with the renewable energy? Yes, we can live, provided the storage technology has to be established. We can do that. For that, we can't invite all the environmental issues only going for a conventional technology, conventional energy. I'm not opposing any thermal or anything. Yes, enough is enough. This country had seen all the fossil fuel vehicles. This country had seen all these conventional energies. Now it is a time to go for renewable energy. This is a time to go for solar. This is the time to see that India is becoming a global hub. That's the reason International Solar Alliance has been set up. When you set up this, you have to come forward with the low-cost funding, with the technology, with the manufacturing, with the development of the solar projects. Either it is a ground mounted or it is a rooftop. Rooftop, everybody knows that we achieved only a small portion. Lot of nitty-gritties are there in the rooftop. It is not possible to explain within a few minutes. All those nitty-gritties has to be sorted out by sitting with the policy makers, by involving and inviting all the people involved in the solar rooftop. I could see when Karnataka announced 9.56 for the solar rooftop, many of the hatcheries, many of the cattle farms, their requirement is 200 kilowatt, but they mentioned that they are going for a 2 megawatt. Because the difference, the loss to the DISCOM, the buyer has to pay more. Instead of 200 kilowatt is requirement, he has to buy 2 megawatts. The loss is there. So that's why many of the such kind of differences, and such kind of policy has been scrapped. So we have to review, sit and review everything, how to strengthen 40 gigawatt of rooftop, how to reach 100 gigawatt of solar energy, how to strengthen the manufacturing, how to come out of these grievances for the funding, how to come out the grievances on land, how to come out of the strengthening the grid, the green corridor, whatever we are getting every country's funding. The Prime Minister, now idea is to invite everybody, let them come to India, make in India. We would like to welcome, we would like to investment, we like to get the technology. Our doors are open, red carpet welcome, 100% FDA also allowed. Now, at the end of the day, Indian banks has to realize that the people, those who are operating the financial institution, is not sufficient. They have to give their first support to the solar energy and the renewable energy beyond the trade and other industry. Then only we can go for that. Every of the developer cannot go for any foreign funding. It is very difficult to manage that. So I requested Ministry of Renewable Energy and the Finance Ministry set up an exclusive bank, whether it's a green bank or renewable energy bank. We should be charged at below 7% rate of interest, then only the low-cost tariff is possible, then only the kind of solar project will come. Finally, only one point, the solar energy need the generation guarantee insurance that we are discussing with various insurance companies. Now, government has decided all the four PSUs in the country is cleared that policy by IRDA. Recently, we are going to launch, Indian Solar Association is going to launch the solar generation guarantee insurance scheme with the support of the Munich Re and Swiss Re. In this also, I am not hesitating to say that Chinese reinsurance companies has not supported this policy. In spite, 90% of the modules comes from China. They say that they can guarantee only for the product. They can't guarantee for the generation. So at this stage, I request, already I met a lot of Chinese people, lot of Chinese developers. I request all of them also, when you show interest to sell the product to India, you ask your reinsurance companies to support for this cost also. So these are the things we have to keep in our mind. So all together, I'm not blaming anybody. So all together, the government, the officials, the funding and the industries, all has to come under one forum to sort out the issues to develop the solar power. Everybody, Prime Minister says that affordable solar power to each and every home under the Saubhagya scheme. This scheme requires a lot of lithium batteries. This also has to be given a serious thought. EV, This also to be given a serious thought. Now, let us discuss later on all the subject related for EV and ESS and other technologies related for module manufacturing, cell manufacturing, and the inverter manufacturing. Recently, a study has come that silica carbide is to be utilized to reduce the cost of the inverter, to reduce the cost and size, thickness and weight of the inverter. So these are all the upcoming and ongoing technologies happening in the country, in the worldwide. So we have to give serious thought on this. Only one thing, without the support of officials, without the support of the bank, we cannot survive in this country, whatever, whoever may be the ruler, whoever, whichever the party. So I request all these people related for these institutions has to have a positive mind like our Eva reformist. So my S-Bank friend will come forward to announce here that what rate of interest he is going to reduce for the solar power. Let it be a token. Let it be a token. Whether you fund for 1 megawatt, 10 megawatt, 100 megawatt, he announced here that should be the motivation for all the developers. With this, let me conclude the speech. Thank you very much, sir. Namaskar. Jai Hind.
Thank you so much, sir, for such a passionate plea for the sector.